Okay, hello everyone. Welcome back to Summoner. I am SIMSteven, also known as Master Fenral. And it's finally time to go back to Lenele now that the demons have destroyed it all. I am not looking forward to doing this. And to be fair, I kind of thought this was going to come in a little bit later than it was. But unfortunately, it came sooner than I thought. I'm dreading this, but not in the same way that I dreaded doing the Liangsheng Forest, in that this part of the game is considered to be one of the hardest parts of the game. And so, we're going to have to make sure we're well prepared before going into Lenele. I want to take a look real quick at how much EXP my party has. Because as soon as we go to Lenele, we can finally complete Durgan's Lucky Charm. And comparing my party members' EXP levels, I think I'm gonna complete it now. And this is kind of why I've been holding off, you know, because I've been obsessive compulsive with making sure everyone's level and EXP totals are roughly the same. Well, Durgan's Lucky Charm gives you 100,000 EXP. But the thing is, here's the catch. We're going to have to do Lenele with just Jekhar and Rosalind. No Flece, no Joseph. So if you have been neglecting Jekhar and Rosalind, and their overall total experience levels are less than Joseph and Flece by a pretty large margin like I am right now, because, well, it's only natural that it's going to happen that way, because how long it takes you to get your car back after you go to Arrhenia, and the fact that Rosalind takes a while to get back as well, because you have to do pretty much all of Ella before you're able to get her back at the party. Yeah, I'm thinking I'm going to take the XP on these two. Rosalind may end up being the highest leveled character, but not by much. In Jekhar, well, he's way behind. He's even pretty much a full level behind everyone else. So I'm thinking I'm going to take that. Second of all, preparations. Like I said, Joseph and Flece can't go inside here because, as Yago told us last time, Sornehan and Gallliene are keeping watch for these two because Joseph, of course, is the summoner of prophecy and Flece is the heir to both kingdoms. So should these two enter Arrhenia, basically all the monsters that are pretty much all around Medivh will come and converge to where we are, and, well, there might also be some magic wards keeping them out, but yeah, they're going to go for the throat if these two made their presence known. So instead, we are going to focus on playing as just Jekhar and Rosalind. And what am I going to do for my equipment setup? Well, one thing I should mention is that I think before we go in there, I don't think you can leave once you start this event. I'm not 100% sure on that, but I'm going to start it, and yeah, we're going to get things going, and I'll do more preparation talk in a minute. Apparently, I had been sitting on the inventory screen for too long that I got into a random encounter in one step.
The skies over Lenele were dark with carrion birds, and even living men, for want of food, ate the corpses of the dead. Avram Market lay barren and desolate, a wasteland of decay, the mighty walls that repelled invaders for hundreds of years now crumbled into dust. Here perished the Duke of Tarimon, loyal to King Bellius to the bloody end. Here the last of the Medivans clawed through the rubble, struggling to feed their children in the shadow of the temple, desecrated and forlorn. The canals of the city turned red with innocent blood, and in the ruins of the palace ruled a new king and queen. Powerful wards had been cast in every corner of the city, watchful eyes waiting for the return of the summoner and Siwa, rightful heir of Medivh's throne. Joseph and Flece remained outside the city walls, for even the king and queen failed to anticipate the return of the summoner's powerful friends, Jekhar and Rosalind of Iona.
Ah, Siwa, that's how you're supposed to pronounce it. Yeah, that's her real name, given to her by Kifeng, her mother, who's also Aoki, as we know her. Either way, I should be the one to fight Gallliene and Sornehan. I should be the one to avenge my father. I'm crazy enough to trust Yago, but what if he's right? I'll be here with Joseph. And what do you got to say, Joseph? Flece and I will wait here. If we enter Lenele, the wards cast by Sornehan and Gallliene will alert them. Jekhar and Rosalind, you must go to the palace and get the scrolls. Yeah, let me double check this real quick, just to see. Well, looks like we can leave if we want to. But we're going to be in it for the long haul, because, well, not to mince words too much, but this is technically the final dungeon of the game. Also, it's also kind of why it's so hard, because you have to do it with just Jekhar and Rosalind. Some changes will happen later, but this is not the final dungeon of the game, to say the least. At least not on this visit. But here's the ward, and I suppose if Joseph and Flece were to cross this line here, basically all of Sornehan's minions would be alerted to our presence, and yeah, it would be very bad for all four of us. So that's why Jekhar and Rosalind are coming here, because, well, they didn't expect us to send just these two to go after Sornehan and Gallliene. And I suppose even if they did, you'd thought, oh, we're too strong for these two because of our Nhuvasarim magics and the dark arts and all that, so on and so forth. Either way, that right there was our first lich that we killed. They're spellcaster skeleton enemies, and they are, in my opinion, the worst normal enemy in the game. And the reason for that is they have a lot, and I mean a lot, of resistances and immunities. Specifically, piercing damage is what they're immune against, and you're going to be fighting a lot of them. And that means bows are completely ineffective against them, and swords are completely ineffective against them. Therefore, make sure Rosalind has a good staff on her. Make sure Jekhar also has a good blunt weapon on him. Because blunt weapons are the way to go in the endgame. I've been saying this since the very beginning, and now, well, if you didn't follow my advice from the very beginning of SLP, yeah, you only got yourself to blame at this point. Anywho, he's still here. Taking the sailor, still waiting for his earring that took us the entire damn game to track down, because this is probably literally the second quest we picked up. Anyways, have you found my lucky charm? Well, let's give it to him.
Stronger.
Last so many times I thought to myself, I should just leave, then a voice would say to me, don't give up hope. You return with your lucky charm, and so you have. Here's a fine sword for your trouble, friend. We got 100,000 XP and the Breaching Claymore, aka the strongest damn sword in this entire game. But then again, don't use it because it's a sword. Either way, we're going to take a look at it and see what we get for all of our troubles. So the Breaching Claymore is a two-handed sword. It's for Jekhar only, and it requires heavy arms 10. But look at the damage on that thing. It's a super slow weapon, but if you're not controlling Jekhar, that doesn't matter too much. Here we are, but 100 base damage is the highest attack power sword, I think, in the entire game. And Jekhar is the only one who can use it. The EXP alone is probably the thing that's worth it more than anything, because 100,000 EXP, even to just these two who were lacking in levels, now get their chance to shine Really, for the first time in the game, because they've pretty much just been side party members who had just been along for the ride this whole time. For now, though, we've got ourselves a long, long, long dungeon ahead of us. So we're gonna take it nice and slow and make sure that we don't get overwhelmed by too many enemies at once. Also, this is another good reason why I spent so much time and effort getting all my chain attacks in Irenia. Earthshaker is a literal lifesaver in this place because it knocks down enemies in an AoE effect or in front of Jekhar. Just because he slams down on the ground and knocks enemies down, that's going to give you a lot more breathing room that you otherwise wouldn't have while you're in here. So take advantage of Jakar's chain attacks. Similarly, we did this as well for Rosalind. If you need help in a pinch, remember that Rosalind has Prayer and Bless as chain attacks, and she can basically buff up our party members, both of us, and really reduce the damage we take in here by just two quick chain attacks. If we get into a fight with a lot of enemies at once, I might end up using it. But yeah, these two have their own benefits, and it's especially helpful to just know how these two work long in advance so that you can take advantage of their skills in here, because you're going to need all of them, if not some really, really good gear while you're in here. But either way, I'm going to get this ball rolling, and of course, ultimate goal is to get into the sewers so we can take the back door into the palace once again. Those sewers, man, I tell you, we're going to have to go through them multiple times throughout the course of the game, and, well, here we are doing it again. Also, the music in the upper levels here is actually quite good, so I'm actually going to let you listen to it for a moment, and hopefully we won't get overwhelmed on our way in, but this is, yeah, once again, one of the hardest parts in the entire game. All right, so I give you at least a little bit of a listen to that. Nice song, especially once it gets going. But don't get to hear it too much when you're here in the outskirts. Also, there aren't too many enemies in the outskirts to begin with. Regardless, we're back to the sewers, and this place has changed. Now, one other footnote I like to make about the enemies around here is some of the enemies we saw, like the Greater Gorgones, appeared back in Arrhenia in random encounters, but there was only like one of these guys there. Well, now you can see we're going to be fighting these guys in greater amounts, especially here in the sewers. In addition to that, there's good drops to be had from these types of enemies. So, once again, I kind of made a point of this back when we fought those Gregolons in Arrhenia, but they drop a lot of good items that you could sell. So you don't really have to worry too much about money. And speaking of other drops, also Onyx Golems? I forget what these guys have. But blunt weapons, once again, make quick work of these enemies, so definitely use them. Yeah, drops, specifically about the liches. You want to fight a lot of liches. You don't want to avoid them because they drop some really good gear, especially for Rosalind, who, of course, is one of our active party members right now. Liches being one of the strongest mage character enemy types in the entire game, have some real nice, and I do mean real nice gear for Rosalind. Some of the best she can get, especially some Magus boots, which they can drop. So if you can, fight a bunch of liches and get them to drop. We'll be fighting a lot more of them in the future, so yeah, definitely farm them later. Now, I don't think we can go this way. Yeah, we can't make an easy trip into the palace. Instead, eventually we need to get to the marketplace and make our way towards, well, essentially the marketplace and the Crown District have now been combined into one map. And everything has been destroyed, of course, so there's a lot less going on except for a lot of rubble and everything. But we need to make our way to the marketplace, and from there make our way to the exit line to essentially the Lenele Temple Plaza. That is kind of essentially a exit line that changes depending on where you are in the game, which is kind of why I said this is the final dungeon in the game, because we're going to the palace right now, but they both essentially go to the same place. Remember the layout of the town prior to going to Arrhenia. So, because of that, we're going to the same place as where the final boss of the game is, but now because the final boss isn't in there at the present moment, this is technically the final dungeon of the game, but not quite just yet. We're going to be fighting pretty much everything we see, so these two can get a decent chunk of EXP. That, well, Joseph and Flece are already pretty far ahead in the EXP department, so we're just getting these two caught up. And then maybe Flece and Joseph might be the one behind. So we're done, but we're also doing this for drops and the loot, because there's lots of good stuff to get here. In fact, I think there's one unique enemy now that I think about it. You are able to go down towards where the Bassite camps were all that time ago. I don't know if you can actually go all the way down there. I think you can, though. But there's, like, a unique enemy down there. I don't think he has any good drops or anything like that. I'm pretty sure he doesn't drop anything. And speaking of drops, I just thought of something. Remember how sometimes loot boxes dropped by enemies are locked? Well, you're just going to have to leave him behind because Joseph and Flece are no longer in our party. So, because we lost our thief, we no longer have the ability to pick locks. Also, yeah, this is a dead end. I kind of knew this. And we did get some potions there a second ago. Once again, I don't use items, so it's kind of something I don't really use. And I just picked them up probably so I could sell them later, I guess. But it does help to just kind of explore everything on your way to where Sornehan and Gallliene are. Anywho. I don't think there were too many enemies back here, so it wasn't that much of a waste of a trip. But there probably are a lot more where they came from if we were to actually go the right way. And also, all the golems that were here that operated these wheels are gone. Suppose they either got killed by Sornhin's men because of how this is really just a backdoor to anywhere in Lenele, especially to them. They're probably like, yeah, we should do something about that. So yeah, you can't use the golems to open up your passageways. Instead, this place is just opened pretty much to so you can go wherever you feel like it, and you don't have to worry about it anymore. Anyways, back to shit waterfall once again. Well, that's a few steps farther. Yeah, thankfully everything here is open. Fortunately, they're stupid and left the doors open so that we could just kind of waltz right in. Otherwise, how would we even get there? I don't know. I mean, the doors have been reduced to rubble, so you can't get out of here. I'm gonna drink gauntlets. I think we already got those, so never mind. I think those were for Joseph anyways, so we can't exactly equip them. And, of course, we're not gonna get all the undead enemies in here. But we could get some more loot, like steel gauntlets from the Gorgons, because, once again, that sells for a lot. In fact, it's one of the best-selling items in the early game, especially if you want to buy the Dreadblade instead of doing the Emperor's Dragon Scales from very early on in the game. Onyx Gargoyle? I don't think we've seen these before, and I don't know what they drop. No particular care, but if we get something good, then I'll take it, of course. But I don't really recall if they actually give us anything good or not. Just like I was saying before, we don't have Flece in the party, so we can't pick locks. Also, I'm dying, so we better make sure that doesn't happen. Double vitalize, she gets close to full once again. And I better not use sacrifice until Jakar's AP gets back up again. Life Legion, though, I'll use that. Okay, one of you guys needs to die. How much health you got? Almost down. Black. Ooh. If I'm not mistaken, this, I think, is Fleece's best hand armor. Again, kind of useless to us right now because he's not in the party. But it is. Well, I think I know why I forgot it even exists, because you only need to get one and then that's it. Either way. Come on, dude. Die, please. Can I use Earthshaker here and knock these guys down? I don't know if these guys can be tripped or not. Let's try and see. These guys might be immune to trip effects, so yeah, I think 3-4, I guess, in total means that they don't, they can't be affected by it. So, Rosalind. Oh, you're silenced. Also, you're taking aggro, too. Hopefully, yeah, there we go. Jokar's got aggro now. Alright. At least he's down now.
It won't open.
I'm gonna take a look around these side paths over here and then maybe call it an episode here, because I knew well in advance this wasn't gonna take me at least two episodes to get through. Maybe three. We might be spending the entire week here. So once again. Let's take one last look down this way to see if there's anything besides a couple of golems that I see. These guys thankfully don't have a ton of health, but also they're super weak to blunt. As you can see, I just did 300 damage with the sacrifice. And that was enough to pretty much kill them. I also don't think these guys can be knocked down as well, because, of course, they got those big tree trunks of legs to keep them upright. The gargoyles are floating, so I have a feeling that slamming the club on the earth wouldn't knock them down either. So, either way. Physics! I guess it actually makes sense. Also, Rosalind, rather than cast Plate of Regular Heal, use Vitalize and heal yourself. You should never let your health drop.
It won't open.
Another locked lockbox there. Okay. So yeah, we're going to take a look down here, and then I suppose call it a day here. Hopefully we'll find something good. I don't really remember this part of the game very well, because I don't like to really grind here in the sewers all that much. I do see some loot. The dragon's wand. Ah, Phylus in halfway decent hand gear. Staff weapons plus 2 and 10 defense. Wanna know the funny thing about that is? Because this was a programmer oversight, and she's been able to equip the iron gauntlets all this time. Yeah, exact same defense. And we bought this from a merchant in Medeva here in Lenele, long before it actually was we were able to get a pair of gloves that had the same amount of protection that she could actually equip. Either way, good stuff. Also, I just saw something that I forgot to talk about last episode. We picked up this burnt robe in the Abbot's house back in Iona last episode. Protection 35, speed 1.5. Or 1.05, resist fire. Yeah, I think that's actually better than what we have by about 5 defense or 5 protection. And an extra point and resist fire. So yeah, she probably should have put that back on her. Put it on her. Wow, why am I getting so tongue-tied right now? Probably should have put that on her before we started. But either way, all's well that ends well. We haven't died yet. Come close to it, but we haven't died yet. So let's kill this guy and we'll call it a day. Yeah. We're probably going to have to let your AP recharge for a little while, because I've been using it all. Using it all in his chain decks. Back, since that's kind of a problem, do you have... No, I don't think you have one of those rings on. We got a ring back in Arrhenia that boosts AP totals. It's not that one. That one. And by putting that on, we should be able to make it so that Jekhar's AP regenerates at a faster rate. Because the higher your max AP, the faster your AP regenerates. So, yeah, I think that's good for now. So, once again, I am SimSteven, also known as Mr. Fenril. Thanks for watching, and I will see you guys next time. I'm leaving you off with a bunch of whooshing noises. Thanks for watching.